Yeah, I'm Jagan. I'm Jagan Teki. Today I'm going to start with you boot from scratch. A little bit discussion about me. I'm a freelance free software engineer coming from India. Mostly I work with the Linux and U-boot, especially in SPI and Spinar and the Allwinner SoC. Most of my work on involving upstreaming the things from U-boot and Linux kernel. And the agenda bits very huge. Like I'm trying to cover all the topics in the U-boot. So maybe it may take around a while because it's having many slides. I may be fast for while talking because of more slides. If anyone has any doubts or questions, you can ask me after this. Agenda I have categorized into these parts, like from how the product is being started with from scratch, and how the development's been started, and what is the future task about the U-boot. And what are the main pitfalls, like what are the simple drawbacks about U-boot? I will talk all the these details. The first category is like all these basic topics from the U-boot. Start from the upstreaming the process to its initial days of U-boot basically. This is just like a history. And most of the history is in Wikipedia. And Danks has started this project in 2000 and become renamed to DOS U-boot, and thanks release of my internship, and Tom Rainey has been taken this custodianship. We have a recent release on 2018.11. This is how community works. Basically the community works all over the world of one of the popular bootloader in the world, like mostly he's always been active since almost years. We have almost 35 plus maintainers, like custodians. We have a release for every 2 months. Like the release period can be categorized into merge window and stabilization period, where these first two weeks can be categorized for merge window, where new features on the bootloader can able to take. For the best, once the merge window expires, there is no possibility for the new features, only the bug fixes can be taken into the consideration. This is just like a typical Linux workflow, like a developer can send a patch and maintainer or anyone in the mail list can review the patch, and the subsystem maintainers can send a pull request to the master maintainer basically. These are the basic hardware that we support till now. Start with the x86 or microblaze or ARM32 or ARM V8. All these boards, and we have a different kinds of boards from the board vendors along with the SOCs. These are the boards till now we supported basically. What is U-boot basically? I'm trying to explain the U-boot start from the scratch to what we developed till now. So basically there's a simple flow, what exactly the bootloader, like anything that runs with the power on reset, and it will start from the boot ROM or bootstrap code. And the bootloader can install or run your kernel or DTB onto the application. This is a typical bootloader. And the days where bootloader starts is just like a simple, like replacing the generic bootloader into U-boot, where most of the IMX platforms can directly boot from boot ROM to bootloader to Linux. This is our first intention towards the bootloader U-boot. And ES has been loaded, like there is a SOC vendors started to say that like all the bootloader stuff cannot be in the U-boot, so they come with a phenomenon called SOC loader. Like this SOC loader is more specific to SOC. Like if you say it's a J-Links, there is FSBL. In Texas Instrument, we have an MLO, and NVIDIA it's called a boot one bootloader or something. So all these bootloaders, SOC bootloaders, are more specific to SOC vendors. Then we have our upstream bootloader, and it's been the Linux kernel later. And from this next step, there is a tremendous development towards SOC loader. Like U-boot came up with an example, like why can't you mainline your SOC loader? So there comes a concept called SPL. So all the SOC loader becomes mainline loaders now. So the U-boot U-boot can be categorized now as a U-boot proper. It's not a U-boot, but a SOC loader can be SPL, like a first stage bootloader. And there is a problem with SPL. Some of the architectures where SRAM is very limited, like 8 KB or something. So some of the hardware architectures like RK Rock Chip RK 3288, they come up with a one more stage called TPL. So we have an exception, like few of the features cannot be fit into that 8K memory, so we can implement a TPL, one more stage bootloader. That's where three stage bootloader come into picture. The source code for all these three stages can be a same bootloader with the same build system. This is how typical U-boot repo started and how you can build for a particular architecture. It can be any architecture. You can export like how normal Linux can build, like configuring your boot def config and just like a cross compile and make. This is U-boot tree, typically like a Linux tree. But apart from the main major differences, we have something called commands. So user can read or write to their storage medias or something. And we have something called ENV, like environment for a particular flash, where how the board is booting from, whether it can be boot from SPI flash or eMMC or something. So those kind of information can be available in the environment. This is how typical bootloader build system will start. The bootloader will take an example of how many stages you are trying to build. Say for example, in this example, I'm trying to build three stage bootloaders. Like one is a U-boot proper, SPL and TPL. U-boot build system will take the U-boot loader first, and it will build the U-boot, and then it will go to the SPL area, like reusing the same drivers in the U-boot, configuring for a particular stages. At the end, it will create three images. One is U-boot and the other one is SPL and the final one is a TPL. That is how build process in U-boot happened. This is a typical boot sequence happening in U-boot. During the power on reset, the bootloader code can be categorized into two parts. One is board init underscore F and another one is board init underscore R. Like before the stack has established or after the stack has been established. Like underscore F means initial stage and underscore R means relocation code. If it finds, as I said, it's a three stage boot process. If it finds TPL, it can again find SPL. I will demonstrate all the stages in the later section. Once it is find the U-boot, it can, whether it can be come into the U-boot shell for user to interact with the commands, or it can boot the Linux. Loading stages, like how we can load the images in the U-boot. There are numerous number of examples you can in the market, like it can be a flashed variant, or it can be anything that is related to SATA, AHA and NVRAM. All the storage medias which is available in the market, those are in the U-boot actually. So you can use a network as a serial, anything as a loading source. And how you can debug the U-boot. Just like a printk, we have a printf, and there is a configuration called config underscore debug, and few of the people still using GDB. And there is a nice example for new boards to port to U-boot, like debug UART. I will explain this in the next slides. What are the U-boot tools? We have very much tools, like if you want to send a patches to the particular maintainer or particular subsystem, we don't need to bother about creating a sub patch or creating a coverlet something. There is a tool called Pathman. It will create all your patches and send to the respective maintainers based on your configuration file. It's easy to use, and we cannot. It can avoid any mistakes that we can create while sending the patch. There's a Buildman, like building all architectures at once. Like if you do any changes in the core area, It cannot make a build happen with the respective boards. So if you use a build man, it can build all the subsystems which is reflecting the particular change. And there is a concept called bin man. Say for example, as I told, there are three images in the U-boot if you go with the TPL, SPL and U-boot. And the user can load each image in the specific offset. So he has a constraint to load in a particular offset. So there is a concept in the bin man that categorizes all the images into one particular image. So he cannot load all three separately. He can load it in a single instance like a bin man. What exactly bin man does is like it creating a multiple instances on the same image. This is how bin man. In this example, I'm loading this SPL along with the U-boot in a single image called U-boot Sunix with SPL.bin. This is how testing happened in U-boot. The maintenance has a handle to maintenance can every time we use a Travzy for the build system. Of course, it's very slow, but we rely on to that particular testing area where we have a Travzy.yml file. So U-boot can take if you push on your particular GitHub area or something. There are some Python framework where your new features or new drivers or new boards can be tested via in the test.py. We have a tracing tool like if developer wanted to know about how exactly the booting stage happened or what is the boot sequence of U-boot, you can go you can use by using trace tool. And there is a nice example about T-boot, like building U-boot and running runtime via in the target itself directly. This is a good example for testing and automatically adding support. And there is a next section like what are the typical images that you can boot. These images can be categorized based on their particular usage of any board or developers or particular these image bootings are more respected towards the SoC vendors or their usage basically. In the early stage, there is an image called legacy. Like if you build any Linux, it comes with a Z image. So you can load into particular location like 0x8000 or something with the ARM base of 32 KB. There is a concept called U image, where you have a fantasy to load anywhere in the DTB, in the DDR location. So U-boot can take care to load a particular location where you can specify in the load address. So these can be categorized as a legacy images. The problem with the legacy images are it cannot be flexible. So we need to maintain the indexing. So there is no possibility to add any features like a security or something. So these kind of legacy images are specific to particular for the developers or something. They cannot be used for the production. And we come with an idea of flattened image tree, where we can mention all images in a device tree manner. Like it can be image for the device tree, Linux kernel, along with the root FS. So this can be extendable to add new features like a security. This is a typical file for fit image. In this fit image, you can see you can have a VM Linux.bin, where that is a Linux kernel, and we have a FDT. I didn't add this root FS since I am using MMC card. So this create a fit image. Those fit image can be categorized into U-boot by using bootm command. Like since I told you the extension possibilities, we have a hash algorithm. So you can add a hash algorithm so that there can be extendable towards the security. There is a concept called ATF, ARM Trusted Firmware, particularly for ARM V8. We use ARM V8 for ARM64 boards. The typical boot flow for ATF is simple. Like as I told, there is a two-stage bootloader. ATF comes with a picture like after SPL. Say for example, if we have an ARM64 board, if the exception level comes with the EL3, the SPL switch back to the L3 and it will go to the secure mode. So ATF will run the secure mode and it will switch back to the U-boot to come out from EL3. So that's where the ATF will run the U-boot and U-boot will run the Linux. This is a typical example or typical image, fit image for ATF. See, as I told, with Linux and DTB, you can mention U-boot as well as ATF image. So U-boot can take care and it can read the fit image and it will load it automatically based on the offset or entry points. Opti. And there is a ARM trust firmware software like that you can recently been added in U-boot. These Opti supported in two types of versions. One is for ARM V7 and another one is for ARM V8. Typical Opti is something like loading in another stage, like as I told, as two-stage bootloader, there is an Opti. So since it is V7, SPL load in Opti. So EL3 comes to trust zone area. So U-boot will switch back to the U-boot proper. And there is one more possibility to load Opti after U-boot. So here Opti will load the Linux kernel. So that means in the U-boot console, you can load the Opti. So Opti will load again to the Linux kernel. But the first stage, SPL loads Opti, Opti will load the U-boot. These are two different scenarios where you can use Opti. In ARM V8 platform, Opti can be reused with the same as ARM V8's V7, but with an example of ATF. Like as I told, ARM trust firmware that is needed for ARM V8. So in this example, in this scenario, SPL will load ATF. So it will go to the L3 and it will take the Opti on the L3 itself and it will load back to the U-boot proper. So it will come back to the L2. So U-boot proper will run the Linux kernel. And there is one more possibility, like SPL load ATF in EL3 and ATF will load U-boot and U-boot will load Opti and Opti will load Linux. These are two different scenarios, like as example in ARM V7. This is mostly on ARM trusted firmware. And there is a software secure boot in U-boot called verified boot. If you wanted to boot an image which is secure, as I told, with a fit image, you can ask a hash algorithm, something like that. We can even add a security algorithm called RSA 252. So the image can be secure. Once it is means secure, it can create two keys. One is a private key and another one is a public key. Private key can be created for image creation. And public key can be created by giving to the trusted source so that they can use the public key and it can verify during the boot process. We have a tool called MKImage that can create a signed image. And the public key, once you can create a public key via OpenSSL, we can pump to the public key into U-boot DTS, like a DTS file. So during the boot process of U-boot, U-boot will take the public key from the DTB and it will sign that and it will create the hash. If the hash is fine, it will boot. Otherwise, it cannot be boot because it's been secure image. This is how we can enable verified boot in U-boot. As I told, there is a concept called fit. We can have a configuration called fit underscore signature. So we can even create add a RSA algorithm. As I told you, you need to create keys first. One is the public and another one is private key. Public key we need to pump to the device tree, that is called fit output. So once in the last step, we need to pump the public key to the device tree so that U-boot can have a public key. So during the boot process, U-boot can take the public key from the device tree and it will verify the hash. This is how typical verified boot example. There is a hash, there is one more algorithm called signature, where I can mention which algorithm I'm trying to use. There is a RSA 2048 is the algorithm for creating a public key and private keys. So I need to mention that signature, and once we can create with MKImage tool. So during the boot process, U-boot will understand the secure hash. Like there is an output called signed value, so it can verify the signed value with respect to public key in the device tree. So once it is validated fine, it can boot. This is like a software kind of a security. And we have one more thing called as a real security, that is called secure boot. And this secure boot, typically I'm taking an example of IMX6 platform. As I told, we need to create a public and private key, something like similar to this secure boot. Instead of pumping your public key into DTB, we need to pump the public key into our BROM, like battery ROM in SOC. So during the boot process, the U-boot or any boot ROM will take the public key from the battery ROM and it will validate the verification. This is how secure boot happen. As I told, there are some tools to create a public and private key. I can pump the private key to the signer, like I need to create a secure image for my input image. So I can pump to the public key to the fuse. So during the boot process of MX6 ROM, it can read the hash, it can read the hash values from the fuse, and it can validate by comparing the input hash from the signer. So once it been validated both, it can boot your image. This is a kind of a real security where you can even burn your public key to the hash, public key to the fuse subsystem. This is how at the end of the signed image look like. There is a uboot.bin, and we have there is a section called signature, where that is signature where MX CST tools can create. At the end, it will create a image with hash algorithm. Those hash will be calculated based on the fuse burned image. So once both are being validated, it will boot. This is called a typical signed booting, and this is how we can burn to fuse. And if you in uboot, you can find if there is a problem to go with a secure. Otherwise, it's very difficult to come out from the secure boot mode with wrong images, especially in the MX6. This is how signed image can be created for the Linux kernel. Even like as I told you, we can create a signed image for uboot. We even create image for umage, like Linux kernel. And few of the people even created for rootfs as well. And this is encryption. Like the difference between the signed image versus encryption is like in the signed image, if there is an input image, the algorithm will calculate the hash and it will payload to that image. But in case of encrypted, entire image can be encrypted. So user cannot read the image, and it can create an encryption and it will create the hash. So during the boot process, it will first create decryption and it will again create unencryption. Like it's a two stage of decryption plus hashing, unhashing or something. While shipping the MX6 process, they come up with the OTP master key. This is very needed for the decryption of particular image. So what exactly is the difference between this with such signing is, we need to create two kind of payloads. One is a header, like a signed image hash, and another is the encryption image. So the encryption image can be only decrypted with respect to the OTP master key from the cam, like it's coming from the MX. Oh, if it is OTP, has been validated, it only decrypt the AES algorithm, otherwise it cannot be decrypt. This is how we can create an encryption image in uboot. There is a deck block that is for decryption block. As I told, with the signed image, there is a signature section. Along with that, we have a deck block. That is how real secure encryption happen. I can come with another stage of boot image process, like Falcon Mode. Falcon Mode is something like we can even skip the uboot in production level. Like we can boot from boot ROM, SPL, and directly to Linux. So it can improve our boot timings values. This is how typical Falcon Mode happens. Falcon Mode need to be configured first. Like we need to boot uboot first. You can configure the Falcon. From next onwards, the boot process will start with SPL and directly to Linux instead of going to uboot. But user can have a flexibility to go uboot with respect to some GPIO pin or some kind of a key in the keyboard or something. These are the typical advantages of Falcon. You can directly boot from SPL and boot up the boot process. There are some configurations you need to create for enabling the Falcon. These are the typical configurations, and as I told, I am not using any GPIO LAN to come to uboot. I am just using Control C, so I just have a simple code. Since I told we need to mention if particular flash sectors or particular flash offset where Linux kernel or device resides, then only the SPL knows that it can boot automatically. This is a typical example how you can load a Falcon, how you can configure the Falcon. This is a normal boot, like two-stage bootloader like TPL, SPL, uBoot Linux. When I enable Falcon, I come up with half of the duration of the boot time. That's end of the boot images section. uBoot features, like since I told you the start from the project, how we migrated towards the new features. These are the typical features which has been developed since from last 4 years. First one is the kconfig. Earlier we don't have something like a Linux kernel build system. Like there is no concept called kconfig in uBoot earlier. So user want to create there is a boards.conf file. User need to add their board along with some configurations enablement or something. So it cannot resist more because since we are adding too many stages in the uBoot, the build system of kconfig cannot resist more. So where we moved to kconfig actually. This is typically same as Linux. But the main differences between Linux kconfig versus uBoot is we have three different .config files for a particular stage. Like if you use the uBoot, TPL and SPL, we have a three .config files. That is a major difference. Other than that, it is typically similar to Linux. The kconfig definition looks same to Linux, and this feature has been added in 2014. We still have a legacy kconfig because of backward compatibility. So the configs which are not moved towards kconfig are listed into config wait list. So if anyone wanted to add any config, he can add it in kconfig and remove it from config waitlist.txt. Yeah, this is the FDT, like Linux FDT. We have we reuse all the FDTs from the Linux, but the loading process is bit different in uBoot. Like we still take device T as a part of uBoot, or we can boot Linux uBoot and DTP separately. These are the typical examples how we use the FDT in uBoot. Like as I told, DTP can be packed into two types. One is the embedded, like we can attach DTP into uBoot, and even we can detach. Like we cannot use the combining image. This is a typical FDT. Like as I told, seems similar to Linux. And there are some properties which are specific to uBoot, like. Say for example, if I wanted to use a MMC subsystem in SPL, so like I wanted to use a device tree in SPL. If I enable a device tree in SPL, entire device tree can be parsed. So there is a problem with the size. So I wanted a particular node of the controller. So I can mention some property called uBoot DMPLock. So it cannot create all the device tree image into bundle. So this can be reduced the size of the SPL. So this is the reason we came up with a property called uBoot DMSPL. But towards the compatibility with the Linux kernel, we create device tree files with an extension of uboot.dtsi. So the device tree nodes which are specific to uBoot can be created by uboot.dtsi. The main advantage of this was, like, since we rely on the Linux kernel, we sync every DTS from the Linux from a particular release. So there is no way to confuse with new features in the device tree. So all the uBoot DTS properties can be resided in uboot.dtsi. We have a FDT library where we can load the FDT in the Linux kernel, similar to Linux, like FDT get property or FDT set property or something. The problem with this is like the this is updated library. Like we cannot rebuild everything, and we cannot if you wanted to update some particular device tree property or node, say for example there is a if there is a TX enable bool, it's zero, if I wanted to enable one, I need to traverse entire device tree. So start from the SOC node, root node towards to particular node where I wanted to update. So this is a disadvantage of traversing slow, where we come up with a concept called live tree, where since I told you like if I wanted to update a particular property in the particular node, I can directly traverse to the particular node address. This can eventually reduce the traversing problem, and we can save the time. There we come with a live tree. Live tree examples like tree device tree can be created with dev node. Like we have a device tree driver model nodes where as I told, dev read U32 will directly go to the SPI max frequency property and it will update it. And additive overlays. We have recently added this additive overlays. Like if the boards come up with say for example a Raspberry Pi has a hat, like hardware attached on top, so they don't want to send a DTS files, so they send a overlay files. So we even support a overlay, DTB overlay, in a two different ways. Like the overlay can be anything that is out of the hardware or board tree. So those are runtime configurable. Say for example we have a Jitto tune device. It can be used for Raspberry Pi and Thinkerboard. If I wanted to add a support for U-boot, or if we wanted to add a support for Linux, maintenance may not accept this to via DTS file. So you need to create a overlay file. In the overlay, we can load overlay in the Linux, in the U-boot in two different ways. One is like a manual, and another one is the FDT, like a fit image area. This is a typical overlay example. See, this is a typical fit image, an example of overlay, where mx6qico.dtb is a real DTP, but mx6qico.mipi.dtb is a overlay DTP basically. This is how I can load overlay in the U-boot. First step is via fit, where I need to mention the load address of the Linux kernel along with the DTB and along with the DTO, like overlay. So the bootem will take the DTB, and along by reading the fit image, it identifies where exactly the DTB resides. So it will load DTB versus and particular overlay combination. We even load manually, like loading a particular DTB address in a particular memory location, and we can even resize it, and we can load directly like Linux. I come up with the last section, last category. This driver model, these features has been added almost since last 3 years. We are still working on it, these areas. I'm trying to cover all the driver model concept till now, basically. What exactly the driver model looks? Since the U-boot started, we have a drivers. Like drivers, like there are not exactly the drivers, they have a function calls. If I wanted to use MMC board, MMC init in my board file, I need to call directly from a board file. So there is no possibility for modularity. There is no concept of building multiple drivers in same platform. So there is a problem with the scalability, and very difficult to maintain. So where we come up with the driver model idea. Like we look device as a driver and U class. Like typical Linux device model, this is like a homogeneous. Like if I take an example of we have a SPI controller, and the SPI controllers can be categorized as a U class core, and individual controller drivers like a Zinc or OMAP or TI, those are the U class drivers. Like if you take an example in the Linux, we have a bus driver and a client driver and the high level driver. Like it cannot be homogeneous, but in case of U-boot, all the drivers are U-class drivers. if it is all these U classes are more specific to the device manager. Like if there is an MMC, we have an MMC U class driver that is core. Individual controller like MMC controller from Zinc is a U-boot driver, and MMC controller from TI is a U-boot driver. All will talk to this U-class driver. That is how I can call it as homogeneous. These have some kind of features like scalable. As I told, we can avoid the direct function calls and homogeneous. And the main advantage of this driver model is lazy initialization. Like in U-boot, if I wanted to, unlike in Linux, I don't want to load all the device drivers respect to the connected device set during the boot stage. I want specific drivers during the load. That can reduce our boot time. So we came up with lazy initialization. Look, like say for example, I'm booting from MMC. I can only, but my board has Ethernet, and my board has something called a NAND. My board has something other peripheral. But during booting time, only MMC driver will load, because that is needed for booting from MMC. Respective drivers will not load until unless if you use it in command line. That is how I can call it as a lazy initialization. And we have a problem with the U-boot driver model as well. Like if I wanted to use SPL on low SRAM areas of SRAM, say for example I have 8K SRAM, I may not use the driver model in SPL. That can increase the size. We are still working on it to make things to go even work with DM in SPL. This is how typical driver looks. First one is a U-class driver. As I told you, U-class driver is a core. And second one is a U-boot driver. That is a Zinc controller. So the category is simple, like we have a core driver called U-class, and we have individual drivers called U-boot drivers. Something similar like we have an operations and probe, and even we can have a, if we wanted to add a device tree support, we have a device tree IDs of match everything. This is how our driver model tree looks like. As I told, there is a lazy initialization. The point where it cannot mention, like if I say root is a plus, like it initialized. But clock is never initialized, because I don't need it in boot process. Even USB don't need it in boot process. So those are lazy initializations. Yeah, we have a clock framework. Clock framework, individual clock controllers, like any from vendors or U-boot class clock drivers. We have a clock core called U-class_clock. So U-class clock is a clock core, and individual controller clock drivers are resides in a particular controller area. So you can get the clock and you can put the clock based on our usage. Like we have clock ops, so individual drivers can call them particular clock operations and consume their clocks. For consuming the clock, we need to get the clock first and update based on the ops. There's a reset framework. Like clock, we have U-class_reset. So the reset U-class is a core class. It having a functionality called DSet the reset and Aset the reset. So the consumer can get the reset first in the driver, and it can Aset and reset based on the pointers. We have a Pi framework for all Pi hardwares. So the Pi class can provide all our Pi access areas, like initializing a Pi and turn off and turn on the Pi. So the consumer first get the Pi, and it will call back to the initialization Pi and turn on and turn off the Pi. This is a three examples of how I can use clock, reset, and reset in on Pi in typical Pi driver in Sunix. This is a Pi driver. I have a Pi operations like Pi init and Pi exit, where I can enable the clock and deset the clock. In the exit, I can disable the clock and set the clock. We have pin controller framework, like in the Linux, and we have all the pin controller functionalities can be good categorized into pin muxing and pin configurations. These are comes via pin controller U-class. So pin U-class_pin_controller is a core. Individual controller pin controller drivers can be reset to call their pin controller core to consume the pin controller, so they can configure the pins during their drivers. There is a power domain framework, so control the power directly from the portion of SOC. There are some categories from Broadcom who use this power domain. They wanted to turn on and turn off the domain directly from the SOC. So we categorize that portion of area is called as power power domain. So the power domain consumer, like any driver or SOC code, can consume get the power domain first, and it can turn on and turn off the power domain. We have PMIC class, and we in the PMIC we categorize the PMIC as a U-class PMIC, as well as attached PMIC can be called as a regulator. So we called as a U-class and regulator. So there are some SOCs where directly use the PMIC, and there are some SOCs there who can use the PMIC and regulator simultaneously. The typical framework PMIC framework, we come with a U-class underscore PMIC. The individual drivers can get and set the PMIC registers. Similar to the regulators, U-class regulators can populate their regulators via device tree or U-boot to platform data. So they can consume the PMIC consumer so that they can set and get the regulators. We have a real-time RTC, like we come up with U-class underscore RTC. So if a consumer want to add the RTC in their drivers, he wanted to get the RTC first, and it will read and write based on their ops provided by U-class underscore RTC. We have similar to RTC, we have a thermal framework where the core clock thermal framework can reuse their thermal areas, so we can get the thermal. Right now we provide only get thermals. We cannot we don't set till now. So we don't set the thermals directly from U-boot. Similar to thermal, we have a timer. So we have a timer GUI class where I can get the timer count based on my consumption of the driver. So the consumer can get the timer first, and you can get the exact count of the timer for their drivers. As I told, the serial framework. Serial framework comes with a U-class underscore serial. All these core drivers are serial U-class. So if the consumer wants to use a particular serial driver, he wanted to create some initialization code, like a serial init and a serial R underscore init. So it is similar to the Linux. We can provide set baud rate and get baud rate via DM serial underscore ops. We have a nice feature called configure underscore debug UART. If anyone wanted to use or add a new board into the U-boot, if you found any mistakes during the boot, you can enable the debug UART and you can get the logs. This is how I can use debug UART. There is a SPI framework similar to Linux. We can get the set speed, get speed, and do transfers via flash, and take the flash IDs or something. So we have a class called uclass underscore spy, and attached that we have a command called as command underscore SPI. This is how typical SPI drivers looks like. We have a since I told like this comes under uclass underscore spy, so the device, so this binding could be as compatible to Linux. So I need to use the same as Linux binding. I can do any operations like set speed or get speed or claim the bus and unclaim the bus, even transfer the speed. And we have come with the I2C framework. They are similar to SPI, because since it's come with the U-class underscore SPI, and we have a GPIO similar to U-class GPIO, similar to Linux. And we have Ethernet, and we have block driver. And the block driver framework in U-boot will follow similar to Linux, like all these block categories into U-class. We have a U-boot, and if anyone wanted to use if anyone wanted don't want to use the device tree, or you can go with the platform data, like a legacy platform device underscore registry in Linux. So he can get rid of the device tree, so he can get the some memory. Like if you want anyone wanted to use the firmware upgrades, these are the firmware upgrades. Because since I'm timing out. Yes, this is a typical three-stage bootloader, how boots with Linux. See, TPL, SPL, U-boot. And we have a demo run if you wanted to can. This is the conclusion. I'm running out of time, sorry.
Okay, thank you, Jagan. We have time, I think, for just one question, if someone have one. No questions?
Do you really have a U-boot on your laptop?
Yes.
Very compliment.
Okay, anyone else? Okay, thank you, Jagan, again.